name is David. I am an engineer here at Spreadly, as well as the token Manbun employee. So this is, if you love your data, set it free. You know, where Spreadly sits in the payments flow means we generate a lot of really interesting data when it comes to payment gateways. And so today I want to share with you how we've gone about building out our infrastructure and data pipelines to really support us as we dig into and gain insight into the data. Hopefully, if you're thinking about getting more insight to your data, or maybe are already starting this project, you can take some tips on how we've gone about solving this ourselves. So with that, let's get started. Now, if you're running a transaction against Spreadly, one of the side effects of that is that we will take a document and store it in our Reoc database. Now, you heard my coworker Yanja talk a little bit about how Reoc is actually optimized for uptime, and that's great. I think if we're all, you know, in engineers and payments, I think we can agree that downtime is a little bit more stressful than other applications, because it oftentimes means the direct loss in dollars, not just productivity. So that's great. We like that uptime. We want that to support our application. What Reoc really does not give us is a way to query that data. So how do we get all this great transaction data that we've been generating from our application into a place where we can actually gain insight from it? So it's a bit of a journey, broken up two parts. So hopefully that makes it a little bit easier to follow the whole trend. First thing we've done is taken advantage of the post-commit hook. And so that's pretty simple. All it does is really every single time there's a database event in Reoc, it takes that event and fires it off somewhere, as also including the data that was happening in that event. So that hook will then send off that data to another application running on the exact same node as Reoc. Now the purpose of this application is really just for one reason, and that's to whitelist data. You know, we're not, being a PCI compliant company, we can't just let our data go around willy-nilly. We need to be very rigorous about the documentation of our data, but also showing that, you know, data does in fact stay here, or it stays to leave our system. So this application, once it whitelists the data that's safe to leave, it then sends it out to our Kafka instance. Now, if you're not sure what Kafka is, that's okay. You can just think of it as sort of like a distributed event stream that this data can then be consumed later on downstream in real time. And Kafka is sort of becoming the like core of our system in many ways. It's slowly been the place where all data flows through, and we've been able to use it to backlog new products that we've been building. It's been pretty exciting to watch it evolve as our system has grown as well. So that's the first leg of this journey. So we're in Kafka now, which is great. It means our data is more accessible. We can do and use it in different ways. What do we do now? Well, I'd like to say that there's sort of this constellation of applications sitting around our Kafka instance. They're all consuming data from different places and using them in ways that are useful for that particular context. In this case, we have one specific consumer that really has just one job, and that's to build batches of all of these database events. So these batches are about 50,000, maybe 250,000 events at a time. And once it builds those batches, it takes them, converts them to a CSV, and then uploads it to AWS S3. What I like to think is S3 is sort of this file system for all AWS services. It's the beachhead if you want to do any sort of big data tooling or gain insight or use any of their stuff. So if you want to do using AWS big data tools, you got to start with S3. The tool we've been using as of late has been Amazon Athena. Amazon Athena is really cool. It's this serverless interactive query tool, which means that you can just point Athena at specific database, or I apologize, specific S3 buckets of structured data, and you can query it using regular SQL statements. There's a lot of us, I think most of us being engineers, probably can write pretty standard SQL. It's really easy, right? So this is really exciting for me. I mean, it's for the first time in like our history, we've been able to query all of our NoSQL data store using just regular SQL statements. It's like all these free data flights, like, trying to like make me feel better. They're like, that's real, baby. I think this is cool. Anyways, so. But this is really exciting for me. You know, we're able to really gain insight into our data. We can provide our data scientists with this really wonderful tool, something that is really specifically tailored towards them. But at the same time, we don't lose that uptime story, right? We get to let Reoc do its job, make sure that it's dealing with the uptime, and then everyone's happy. So this is just kind of the beginning. It's really high level overview, but what we're looking to do in the future is actually pull in data sources from all over the place, right? So you can imagine having billing subscription data, website data, everything flowing through Kafka. We're all batching that up, pushing that to S3, and now we can use queried data across the board, across our entire system, using one tool. So that's a really, really high level overview. If you want to talk details, please come find the conference. I'm really easy to spot because I have this big red shirt and